We're going to continue in our series, Simple Christmas, looking at this idea today of love over hate. Of course, our gospel reading today was from the Gospel of John, and today we lit the candle that represents the word love. And as we see in this world, I'm not sure there could be a more fitting word for us today. Hate abounds in this world, in our communities, and sometimes, if we're honest, even in our own hearts. Hate is the default setting for our hearts, if we're honest with ourselves. You and I in our flesh are not predisposed to being a loving person and to all we come in contact with. Now, that doesn't go over well with some people because we like to consider ourselves, well, hey, I'm a good person, I'm a kind person, but the truth is, it's easy to be good and kind to those who are good and kind to you. But how easy is it to return love and kindness to those who don't show you love and kindness? So when I say that our natural kind of default setting is not necessarily predisposed towards love, that's what I mean. And I think if we're all honest, we could all agree and say, yeah, that's probably me most days. But what do our hearts do when they don't feel love then? How do we process that? How do we follow Jesus in that? Because for many before Christ, that was a sufficient idea, to love those who love you and hate those who hate you. This idea of loving those who hate you, rather, that has always been hard. But as we've looked through this series, Jesus coming redefines things for us. It challenges us, forces us to reflect on things today. So we're going to be reading from the book of Matthew, and including our gospel reading from John today, looking at this idea of love over hate. John 13, 34 and 35 says, "A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must also love one another. By this, everyone will know you are my disciple, if you love one another." So Jesus is here talking about how you and I, fellow Christians, the church family, would treat one another, and then he expands on this idea in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5. He says, "You've heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes the sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends the rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you have love for those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even the pagans do that?" Jesus says here that we are to have hearts full of love, not just to those in the church body. Hopefully, in the church body, it should be easier for those to love one another, or family in Christ. But he says we are also to have love for all we come into contact with, our neighbor and our enemy, those who respect us and those who revile us. This is a major redesign, a redefinition, a rewiring of how you and I must process living in this world. As I've said this morning, and I think the scriptures argue, it's not a natural default setting for our hearts. It will challenge us. And I think today will challenge us in how we live in this world with those around us. But before we get to our points today on love, I want to talk about something, because I've given sermons in the past where we've talked about forgiveness or love or these processing through relationships, and sometimes they can get a little bit off the rails because people assume what I'm saying rather than hearing what I'm saying. So I want to kind of create this caveat. Because as a Christian, you have no choice but to love others. I can say that right from the scriptures. As hard as it is, as difficult it is, as much hate is holding on in your heart, the path of forgiveness and the process of forgiveness and love is a non-negotiable path for Christians. It's just non-negotiable, and I didn't come up with that. Jesus did. So he's the one who gets to set the terms and service. But some of you hear that and you're like, yeah, okay, that's easy. What's the issue here? But some of you sitting here today, and you've suffered abuse, both physical, emotional, whatever, or you've lived with people who've done unspeakable evil to you and yours, and you can hear this and you can think, this dude has no idea what I've been through, and if he did, he wouldn't ask me to engage with that person again. Hear me when I say, choosing not to hate someone and choosing to let go of that hate in your heart and choosing to walk towards love does not equal a relationship with that person necessarily. Doesn't mean you might even speak to that person ever again. You might have drawn clear boundaries and good boundaries in your life so they can't influence you or abuse you anymore, and to that I say amen. But today we're not speaking about that. I need to make that clear because some in here will have this idea of thinking, well, if I choose to forgive and walk towards love, I'll need to become their best friend. And the truth is, it's far from that, far from it. So to keep that from swirling around in your mind and hopefully keep tracking with you, I kind of wanted to set that up as a parameter because the truth is, I think God has something for you today. As we said, love isn't our natural default settings for humans, according to the scriptures. So how in the world do you and I choose love over hate? Well, our first point today is on that vein. Our love must flow from Christ's love for us. Any conversation about love that does not begin here is destined to fail because you and I do not have it within ourselves to love all of those around us well all the time. We get grumpy. People rub us the wrong way. People use checks in the cashier's line. And how are you supposed to love people like that? Yesterday, I was driving behind someone going 5 miles under the speed limit. I did not feel love in my heart for my fellow man in that moment. And while that's silly, but that's the truth and the reality. So how am I know what I felt. I know what I felt in that moment. How are you and I supposed to have empathy, compassion, and love for that person in that moment? If we just enter into each day and rely on our good nature to will us through, we will fail. To love others around us well, we must feel that connection to Christ and find him as the source of our love. When we walk in relationship with Christ, we will find our heart molded and shaped with different priorities and different agendas, and they'll be Christ priorities and Christ agendas. We will look for opportunities to love others simply for the fact that we are loved by Christ. We will forgive others because we know that we are forgiven by Christ. We will have grace and patience with others because we will know the grace and patience that the Lord Christ has had with us. We'll know the journey we've been on. We'll know how much patience God's had with us. And by the power of the Holy Spirit and the help of the Holy Spirit within us, we can engage the opportunity around us to love those and show the love of Christ that we feel from the Lord. So this provides a bit of good self-reflection for you. Maybe you don't swing full on into hate in your heart, but at best around you, you're neutral to other people. How well do you feel the love of Christ in your own life? Because it's going to be a difficult task as we continue on in this sermon, this idea of loving around you well. If you don't feel loved by Christ, if you don't feel engaged by Christ, it's often been said that a cup can only spill what it contains. So what is pouring into you, and then what are you able to share with others? And while it may sound cliche, but it comes from that daily relationship and filling with Christ that we find this love. We find it in prayer. We find it in reading the scriptures. We find it in devotions, and one of the ways I find it most is through listening to worship music and being reminded of God's love for me through song. It's in that relationship that we can feel love when our own cup is filled and we will find ourselves being able to give that love away to others. And it takes discipline and genuinely walking with the Lord. It will take that walk with Christ and that conviction from him to keep us loving people well. because it simply isn't our default nature. Loving others is hard, even in the best of relationships. Loving everyone seems nearly impossible, because love isn't what Hallmark movies and those cheesy movies that some of y'all love around the Christmas season. That's not what love really is it? Love isn't butterflies and such. Love is far more real. And we must define love properly if we're going to give it away properly. So our next point today is this. Love isn't puppies and rainbows. It's gritty and carries a cross. If Jesus is the source of our love, he must also be the example and the definition of our love. He must show us what love really is. Because it would be easy for you today to hear, "Yeah, hey, Pastor Craig, I get it. I'll be a little friendlier. I'll try and keep my temper down. I'll say hello to the greeter at the grocery store. You know, I hear what you're saying. I need to be, you know, just kind of a gentler person, a friendlier person." It would be easier to process through this sermon and just simply think, I'll be kind of more bubbly in the community. That's what love is. But Jesus' life shows us that love isn't just the easy stuff, the puppies and the rainbows, so to speak, the stuff that comes naturally, the stuff that doesn't cost us anything. What does the kind word to the Walmart greeter cost you? Nothing. A little piece of your humanity. And so, sure, that is an act of love, but Jesus defined love in such a more dramatic way. Jesus defines love as carrying a cross and going to his death for sinners. That's how Christ defines love, by laying down his life for others and by putting others before himself. Jesus washed the feet of the disciples. He served them. He died for them. This, too, must be how we define love in our life if we are going to love others well and show them Christ. It will change how you live. And you will see a difference, because love is gritty and it carries a cross. It means you will suffer that difficult person at the workplace that absolutely drives you up the wall. Now you're all thinking of them. Don't say it. You'll treat them with kindness, with decency, even when they might not fully deserve it or have earned it, so to speak. You will serve them and help them when they wouldn't necessarily do the same for you. It means you'll care for aging loved ones in whatever way that is, even when it's incredibly costly for you. Caring for aging loved ones is one of the most costly ways you'll serve in this world. It's very difficult. You'll serve them the way Christ has served you. You'll try and cross-carry for them. It means in your marriage, you'll bear with your spouse through the ups and the downs, the mistakes, the harsh words, the difficult finances, the medical situation. Because, church, love bears down and digs in. It has the right grit to stick around even when others would flee. It continues to try and operate with kindness and decency and grace when the emotions and the feelings are frayed and seemingly past their breaking point. It's why you can stay married or stay in relationship when you still could easily say, "I don't love that person anymore." And what you're saying is, "I don't feel puppy dogs and rainbows because the bills are due, I'm sick of their attitude, and I don't like the way they do the dishes." You don't feel that love anymore. And so if love is defined as a feeling, in that moment you will say, "I'm going to leave because I don't feel it anymore." We know on the night Jesus was betrayed, he prayed to heaven and said, "God, if you can take this cup from me," meaning the cross, "please do." I think you could argue that Jesus didn't really feel like going to the cross. And thank the Lord that Jesus didn't define love based on his feelings. So if you love and you bear down and you have grit and you stick around and you carry a cross and you forgive and you serve even when you don't feel it, you'll start to see the path of our Lord. Love gives the benefit of the doubt and tries to assume the best in situations. Love doesn't gossip or slander even when others start it. Love returns evil with grace, and in doing so, shows off our Savior. By his love, we are saved. So in his love, we walk out that salvation. If love doesn't have grit, if our love is not an action that moves us towards other men and women, even when it's costly, it is likely that this world will not change much, because hate abounds and it will eventually swamp a cheap knockoff love. That is what we're seeing in this world. If you're wondering why this world continues to get darker and darker, it's because we haven't defined love properly. That bears in, that gives itself, that hurts, that carries a cross, because hate will overwhelm. I'll do something nice for you when you're nice to me. Hate will swamp that boat every single time. Thanks be to God, Jesus didn't define love that way. And he doesn't call his followers to love others in this world this way, because true love is gritty. It's the kind of love that can change your home, that can change your church, that can change your workplace. It's the kind of love that made the church in this world. By sharing what they had with one another some 2,000 years ago, this collection of a couple hundred people changed the world by the way they loved one another. They shared what they had. They cared for one another. They bared with one another. When a plague broke out in Rome and everyone fled because everyone was infected and diseased, the Christians went in and helped people die. And then when people didn't die, they converted to Christianity, because the ones who were there with them were the Christians. The ones who didn't flee with them were the Christians. So Christ continued to build his kingdom through love. And many of you sitting here in this room because someone has loved you well. Some of you have been invited to church because someone loved you well. And it wasn't just a simple like, yeah, come to church with me, but they've shown you their love by how they've walked with you in this life. If love is our calling, we mustn't see it as something flimsy, but rather a robust and gritty action. It's how Jesus loved us by going to the cross, and it's how he continues to love his church by forgiving our sins and walking in relationship with us. It's the love we receive from him so we can share it to others. We must be connected to Christ if we want to love, and we must define love properly, which may have you feeling like, well, yeah, but that sounds exhausting. And frankly, it is. Loving this world well is exhausting, but it is also a gift, because you know what is also exhausting? Just living in this world. Just living in this world is exhausting, and a heart full of hate will be exhausting, because it will leave you frustrated and burned out and jaded with few close relationships. It's why our final point today is this. Hate in our heart hurts us too. Love isn't just our call, it's also a gift. God has a tendency to do something really cool with the things he calls us to, where they're really gifts to this world and this community, but they also bless us. Practical example, when you start to embrace generosity, specifically financially, it is one of the most fun things that God can take you on. Because you're usually pretty disciplined in how you manage and steward what the Lord has given you. So usually your bills are paid and there's some security in that. But then you also get to be a part of the bigger picture in the kingdom and fund ministries and missions that mean something to you. And then it also blesses the ministries and missions that mean something to you. So he calls us to this piece of generosity, and it blesses us, and it also blesses others. We are called to serve, which blesses us because we know we're a part of the community and the kingdom, but it also is good for the church. Church is no different with the call to love those around us. But one of the biggest gifts is that it frees our heart from hate. Martin Luther King, he's one of my favorite authors and preachers. He's a prolific preacher if you ever listen to some of his sermons. But one of his famous quotes was, "I've decided to stick with love because hate is too great a burden to bear." They asked him, why don't you, you know, these white supremacists that showed up against King in the civil rights movement and openly hated and reviled what the civil rights movement meant, why don't you hate them? And King's answer was simple: because it's too much of a burden. I don't want to carry that around in my heart. And it's why I wanted those in the beginning who have every earthly reason to hate a person because of the things they've done or the things they put you through to keep listening. Because the truth is, today I wanted you to find this freedom. I wanted you to find this freedom in your heart, not because of what they did was okay, and not because it makes and it might not take a ton of time and prayer to really let go of that anger and hatred. It might be a years-long journey that you go on. But because love isn't just our call, but it is also a gift. To walk around with the anger and the frustration and the bitterness in your heart is only hurting you. The truth is, unfortunately, most of the time, they've moved on. So you walk around with that pain, you walk around with that anxiety, you walk around with that frustration while they're out living their life, not even considering you, and God is saying, here, let me have that. Let me carry that for you. Let me walk that burden out for you so that you can walk around in my peace, in my truth, in my comfort, in my freedom. It's not just our call, but it is a gift for the broken and hurting hearts. To learn to let go and to trust God and that His way is better. Even when it's painful and even when it's hard. And maybe that's the gift Christ is offering you this Christmas, to take what is aching inside. It won't happen overnight. There'll be setbacks. But a heart of love is a gift from God. And when you feel that love towards Christ, you'll realize that it's really hard to hate someone and try and love everyone at the same time. So Christ will have a way of boxing out that hate and filling the gap with love. As I started this morning by this message by saying, love isn't common in the world anymore, at least the kind that is gritty, that digs in, that carries crosses. If you and I want to make an impact in 2022 and beyond, we must be the kind of church that when we say we love, it's not just a smile and a friendly handshake, but it's a love that carries a cross for others in need and points to God as our source of strength and peace and witness. We remember that Christ is our example, and with Christ as our example, He has made our calling love. And in His name, love can become greater than or overcome hate. Let's go ahead and pray as the worship team comes forward. God, thank you for this day. We pray, one specifically, I should have done this earlier, Lord, but we thank you for those little kids, their hearts, just the opportunity to watch them grow and walk alongside them. It blesses all those who are gathered. And I pray, God, for us, that we would take your love into this community, into our homes, and into this church, and that we would love others the way you've shown us how to, that you would be our example. Be with us, Jesus, as we continue to worship you in song. We pray this in your name.